Welcome to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Well, if you ask me where I come from, here's what I tell everyone. I was born by God's dear grace in an extraordinary place where the stars and stripes and the eagle flies.
Hello, radio listeners, and welcome to the Conscience of Kansas radio program. My name is Paul A. Ibbetson. I am your host, and you're listening to the fastest-growing, most conservative talk radio in the state of Kansas and beyond. A special shout-out today to all of our Patriot 105.7 listeners. We have a great show for you today. In the first half of the program, we're going to talk about a myriad of Kansas news, and I got to tell you, some of it is really annoying to me. We're going to talk about how free hunting and fishing licenses for seniors in Kansas is going to go away. That's right. Got to make a little money. Can't have those seniors having free hunting and fishing licenses. We're going to talk about the hunt for Bigfoot in Wichita, Kansas.
What?
Yeah, we're going to talk about that. We're going to have KU law professor Steve Ware on to talk about how Kansas judges are appointed. I think you'll find this very educational. And in the second half of the program, we're going to have Dr. David Mercado on to talk about his books, his screenwriting, and a very interesting new book along with Jack Cashel entitled Officer's Oath. And you're probably hearing it in my voice today. I'm a little under the weather, but fear not. When my body is weak, my mind and spirit remain strong, and every day I'm on the air, I perform better than the President of the United States. The Conscience of Kansas radio program is about to begin.
If you please, to take off the mask to give the better picture.
Great Scott, Batman, take off his mask.
The woman must be mad.
Please, Chief O'Hara, all of you. This young lady is a stranger to our shores. Her request is not unnatural, however impossible to grant.
Impossible?
Indeed. If Robert and I were to remove our masks, the secret of our true identities would be revealed.
Completely destroying their value as ace crime fighters.
Sure, ma'am. Not even Commissioner Gordon and myself know who they really are.
In fact, our own relatives we live with don't know.
But your so curious costumes.
Don't be put off by them, ma'am. Under this garb, we're perfectly ordinary Americans.
And now here is Paul A. Ibbetson, the czar of radio coolness.
Bigfoot sightings in Wichita, Kansas. Come on. Thank you, Emily, and welcome everyone to the program. We're glad you're listening. In Kansas news from the Associated Press, I'm not kidding, TV crews to visit Kansas in search of Bigfoot. We're talking about Sasquatch, Yeti, the North American version of the abominable snowman. A film crew for Animal Planet Network is coming to Kansas next month to look for evidence that Bigfoot might be roaming the state. Finding Bigfoot producer Sean Mantooth. And when you got a name like Sean Mantooth, I want to look at you. I just want to make sure you're not a Cro-Magnon kickback. But anyway, Mantooth says the TV crew will be in Wichita, in the Wichita area, in late January to film scenes for the show. He wouldn't say where the hunt will take place because he doesn't want anyone to try to pull a hoax. Oh yeah, well, you're certainly not in Kansas looking for Bigfoot based on a hoax already. A town hall meeting, going back to the article, a town hall meeting is scheduled for January 26th in the Wichita area, but Mantooth says the location hasn't been determined. The most recent Bigfoot report in Kansas was in Sedgwick County in 2006 by a husband and wife who said they felt like they were being watched and then heard a guttural growl. Good Lord. Was your cousin Earl on the moonshine about that time? you know, traipse around the back forest, howling at the moon. Maybe there was a methamphetamine cook behind a hay bale. One thing about Kansas is we got enough hunters down here. If there is a Bigfoot traipsing around, he's going to get bagged and tagged. Personally, I'd like to get Bigfoot in the process of chewing down on one of our Kansas mountain lions that no one wants to believe in. Shoot them both from the safety of a deer stand. Mount them together and sell it to Bass Pro. Like to have my name on a little plaque down at the bottom. In our Can We Sink a Little Bit Lower in the State of Kansas for a Buck segment of the show, we see from the Associated Press that free hunting and fishing licenses for Kansas seniors will end. From the article we read, Kansans between the ages of 65 and 74 have only a few days left to enjoy hunting and fishing for free. The state will stop providing free hunting and fishing licenses for people in that age range starting in January. The exemption originally began in 1971. State officials estimate ending the practice will bring in an extra $900,000 to $1.5 million. So in other words, screw you, Grandpa. To hell with your fancy, fangled ideas of enjoying the state of Kansas in your golden years. We're going to put it to you. Now, I don't know if you're over 74 years old, if you've managed to live that long with something not taking you out, whether it be natural or unnatural, if the state of Kansas, in their lust for a few extra bucks, will allow you to throw a line in the water and catch a bass without having to throw a few dollars from your Social Security check into the state coffers so we don't have to trim any of our spending. This is really inexcusable. And hey, while Grandma and Grandpa may not be doing too good enjoying the fishing and hunting here in the state, we certainly have a Kansas casino that's going to have high revenues. From the Associated Press, we see that lottery officials say revenue from the Kansas Star Casino in its first 10 months in operation has exceeded revenue earned by the other two casinos in the state. The Kansas Lottery Commission says the Kansas Star Casino, which opened in Mulvane on December 20th, 2011, has earned almost, can you guess how much money? Would you even fathom it? Don't even try. You're lowballing. They've earned $158 million through the end of October. That is more than the revenue earned in nearly the same time period from the Boot Hill Casino in Dodge City and the Hollywood Casino in Kansas City. The Wichita Eagle reports that the Kansas Star Casino employs about 1,000 people. From the Associated Press, we see a national group. This is the Freedom From Religion Foundation. Are now attacking another city in Kansas. This time, it is the city of McPherson that has a police chaplain program. This program allows two Christian ministers to ride along with McPherson police officers to counsel those officers and to be present when officers are informing other families about deaths. And the Freedom From Religion Foundation doesn't like it. They've contacted the city, and you can bet they have threatened to sue this city on behalf of some, quote, unhappy citizen, unquote, in the city of McPherson. That's probably a load of crap. And they're going to put pressure on this little Kansas town. I want people to know out there in Radio Land, we have officially here on the Conscience of Kansas radio program requested a debate with this heathen organization. If they're man and woman enough to come on the radio and discuss this issue with me, it will be carnage on the airwaves because I am not putting up with this crap. It might be because I don't feel good, but it's probably because I know right from wrong that these people make me angry. I'm going to take some ibuprofen. We're going to go to a commercial break. We'll be back with more of the Conscience of Kansas radio program in a moment.
Oliver's Tale, a squirrel story of love, courage, and revolution. Check out radio host and author Paul A. Ibbetson's fictional version of Animal Farm with a conservative twist. Oliver's Tale is a thinker's piece for teens through adults, written in the same spirit as George Orwell's Animal Farm. Oliver's Tale is a story of how one very average squirrel became a servant of God and led a revolution for freedom against tyranny. Oliver's Tale has its own unique and relevant social, political, and religious message for today's world. Get your copy today.
Welcome back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program with Paul A. Ibbetson.
Thank you, Emily, and welcome everyone back to the program. We're glad you're listening. Boy, Oliver's Tale would make a great Christmas present for your teenage readers. We really have had great success with those readers. And if you want to know about the Patriot Act, then I've got a great book, really one of the top five books in the country, entitled Living Under the Patriot Act, Educating a Society. I wrote it back in 2007, and slowly this book has been used and continues to be used as an educational tool in law schools. I just got what will be my third request to use the book in the educational curriculum at a college. This was from Southwestern Law School in California. They're requesting to use chapters 5, 6, and 7 for my book. Here's a part of the email. It says, the professor, Robert Pugsley, would like to use these sections in a course materials packet that will include various articles and cases. These materials will be used as reading assignments for our law school students in a course called Legal Arguments About Moral and Political Issues Seminar for their spring 2013 semester. 24 copies will be made and printed for 20 students and our school library copy, one master copy and one print shop copy. And of course, we let them do that because we want those future lawyers, especially coming out of California, but everywhere, to have the knowledge found within my 2007 book. And it's available to you, the layman, the unwashed, really the people that make this country work. You can go to Amazon and get a copy of Living Under the Patriot Act, Educating a Society, good enough for law schools around this country, but made for people just like you. All right, let's go to my interview with Steve Ware, talking about where Kansas judges come from, how we appoint them. All right, radio listeners, today we have a special guest in Stephen Ware. Stephen is a professor at the Kansas University School of Law. And Steve, we'd like to welcome you to the Conscience of Kansas radio program.
Thanks for having me. KU School of Law is where I work.
And, you know, I've already forgiven you as a K-State University graduate. A lot of great students there at KU School of Law. And you've written a wonderful article, a really thought-provoking one to me, in the Lawrence Journal World. It talks about states, judges and the selection kind of being undemocratic. And I was wondering if you could tell our Kansas listeners a little bit about how Kansas judges are selected.
Thank you. I'd love to do that. And K-State doesn't have a law school, but we've got tons of great law students here at KU from K-State undergrads. So you all are well represented with top quality lawyers around the state. And honestly, that's the issue here, is not whether lawyers are good or bad people, whether lawyers are good or bad at doing their job. The question is whether lawyers ought to have more power than other citizens in selecting judges, and in particular selecting the most important judges in our state, the Kansas Supreme Court and the Kansas Court of Appeals. Now, many of your listeners are conservatives, and conservatives have known for a long time about the importance of judges. At least since Roe versus Wade, when the U.S. Supreme Court in the 1970s interpreted the U.S. Constitution to recognize a right to abortion and prevent states from legislating in the other direction, conservatives have realized the power, the importance of judges in making law. Because our Constitution at the federal level and at the state level has some vague or ambiguous provisions where reasonable people, including reasonable judges, can disagree about how to interpret those provisions. And we have the same problem with statutes passed by the legislature here in Kansas or by Congress or any other legislature, that they leave room for interpretation. And it so happens that when judges interpret constitutions and statutes, there's often a predictable pattern where more conservative judges interpret the law in a more conservative way and more liberal judges interpret the law in a more liberal way. So it really does matter the politics of judges. And this is especially true at the state level, like our Kansas Supreme Court, because state courts also make the common law. Common law is judge-made law. And here again, if you have more liberal judges, the common law of a state tends to move in a more liberal direction. If you have more conservative judges, common law of that state tends to move in a more conservative direction. So judges have a big influence on the direction of the law. And what's unfortunate here in Kansas is that the selection process for these judges is so closed. It's so secretive. It's so insular. Basically, Kansas lawyers have the majority of the power in selecting these important judges, and the average Kansas citizen has much less. Can I explain how the system works?
Yeah, please do.
When there's a vacancy on the Kansas Supreme Court or the Kansas Court of Appeals, our state's top two courts, when there's an open position on either of those courts, there's the center of the process is the nominating commission, the Kansas Supreme Court Nominating Commission. This commission basically takes job applications, and then it narrows down the pool of applicants to its three favorites, and it sends those three names to the governor. And the governor must pick one of those three people. And that person is thereby appointed to the court, Kansas Supreme Court or Kansas Court of Appeals. There's no further process. The entire process is this nominating commission and the governor. There's no role for the legislature or anyone else. So with the nominating commission playing such a big role, we can see that it's really the gatekeeper to the Kansas Supreme Court. There's no way somebody gets on that court unless they're one of the three finalists, one of the three nominees chosen by the commission. So if you think about it the way I do, you're interested in the question of who appoints the commission, who picks the pickers, if you will.
Yeah.
And that's where Kansas does it in a way different from any other state. None of the other 49 states do it the way Kansas does, where our bar, that's our state's lawyers, gets to pick a majority of this commission. No other state gives the bar the power to select the majority of a nominating commission with this kind of power. So it's really just 10,000 people in the entire state of Kansas who get to select the majority of this crucial commission that's the gatekeeper to the Kansas Supreme Court. A lawyer in Kansas gets to participate in an election for these members of the commission that the other 2.9 million people in Kansas don't get to participate in. In other words, my vote or your vote, if you're not a Kansas lawyer, is worth less than the vote of a Kansas lawyer. A Kansas lawyer's vote is worth far more than a non-lawyer's vote in these important elections.
I don't like that. Well, tell me, has this, since we're doing our own thing compared to the other states, has this been a long-standing process? Has this been in place for a long period of time? And then maybe tell folks what might be a better option.
Well, this process was created outside of Kansas in the early 1900s during the Progressive Era, when the idea of some thinkers was, let's get experts running government.
Yeah.
Let's not have politics involved. Let's have the experts. And that Progressive Era mentality, when it applies to the judiciary, the idea was that lawyers are the experts, and they'll pick the best people, and they'll keep politics out of it. But, of course, we've seen over time, no, you can't keep politics out of it. When you're talking about judges who have such a big influence over the direction of the law,
right,
people's political views inevitably are going to play a role. And really the question is, do you want the politics out in the open, where everybody can see it and where every citizen has an equal vote, or do you want to have the politics hidden in a commission that hardly anybody knows about, where one small group of people, the bar, has the lion's share of the power? So Kansas enacted this system in the 1950s. The first state to enact it was the 1940s was Missouri. So we call it the Missouri Plan. And there's about eight or nine states in this part of the country who have a version of the Missouri Plan. None of the other states are as extreme as Kansas is in terms of how much power it gives the bar. But there are some other states that are close, and Missouri is one of them. There are, though, two other ways state judges around the country are selected. A lot of states use a system that's very similar to what we have in the U.S. Constitution for selecting federal judges. Federal judges, the president nominates somebody and the U.S. Senate votes to confirm or not.
We'll be back with more Professor Steve Ware when the Conscience of Kansas Radio program returns.
Without a doubt, gotta do one burn down. Just running out of here.
Welcome back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program with Paul A. Ibbetson.
Thank you, Emily, and welcome everyone back to the program. As always, we're glad you're listening. You know, right now where I'm not feeling too well, I've got all this sinus drainage going down my throat. It makes my throat sore and make my voice go in and out. My mom said you need to shoot this saline solution down your nostrils and it will help clear out the phlegm and all that. And I hate it. It makes me gag when it comes back. I'd almost rather be waterboarded, but I'll be dogged if it doesn't help. And so I'm shooting saline solution and keeping on trucking. And we're going to go right back to our interview with Kansas University law professor Steve Ware at this time.
Votes to confirm or not that person to the court. Similarly, many states have the state senate voting on whether to confirm or not the governor's nominee to a state court. So that's one alternative to what we have now in Kansas that many other states use. And then, of course, the other alternative is electing judges. And here I mean contestable elections, where two or more candidates can run for the position, just like electing a governor or a senator or whatever, where multiple candidates are on the ballot for judges for voters to pick a judge. Many states around the country use that system for their state Supreme Court, and large parts of Kansas use that system as well for selecting trial courts, the district courts.
Yep.
Around the state.
Yeah, I've seen those on the ballots when I've voted in the past. And, there's arguments to be made to both sides. They can say that those judges that are on there sometimes run unopposed in elections where it doesn't matter, or they may have name recognition. I'm always a guy that probably leans towards the idea of putting the vote into the American people's hands, especially when it comes to judges that are going to make decisions that's going to directly affect their lives. That's not the liberal position, to let the great unwashed have a say in that. But it's an interesting thing. Now, you have this wonderful article in the Lawrence Journal World. I found it very thought-provoking. We're going to link it up for our listeners to read. What's been the response from people to this article you wrote, this opinion article?
Well, thank you. I've been writing on this issue for many years now and have published in the Lawrence Journal World, the Wichita Eagle, the Topeka Capital Journal, and some longer, more academic articles with, mm-hmm. Lots of footnotes and everything. So if somebody wants to just Google my name, Stephen Ware, and judicial selection or Kansas Supreme Court, they can find all of this information. And I've gotten a great reception as I've spoken around the state. I've traveled around the state to, I think I'm up to 11 towns now. And as soon as people hear that the reality of the Kansas system is that it's so closed and gives so much power to a small group of people, they appreciate the danger. Even if people don't know the ins and outs of how judges are selected and what judges do, most Americans have a healthy skepticism of concentrating a lot of power in a small group of people, and especially then making it a secretive, kind of hidden process. Most folks instinctively understand it's better to get things out in the open with sunshine.
Well, yeah, I think you're right. And I think I know from covering the Kansas politics here on the radio that there is a large number of people that are hungry for this information that don't always know where to look. And people that listen here on the Patriot, they say, well, we hear all this information about different things across the country, but not in Kansas. We want to get this information. So we're happy to link up your stuff, and we will actually open up a cornucopia of your writings to people so they can really just see a lot of different things and get educated on the issue. It's fascinating. Now, I got to tell you, the more I learn about this, the more I kind of get hot under the collar, because I see that the people in Kansas are getting bypassed, and yet they're affected directly by these decisions. But if we have a dialogue get out there and we get public participation, that seems to me to be one of the fundamental ways that you bring about change.
Yes, that's exactly right, Paul. And I really appreciate the efforts you and your listeners will do in spreading the word, because the legislature is expected to consider this issue again this year. It's voted on this issue for the last few years, and with the recent changes in who's elected to the legislature, It's quite possible that this is the year a bill actually gets passed and changes the system. So it really behooves our citizens in Kansas to learn the issue and express their views to their elected representatives.
Yeah, absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been speaking with Steve Ware. He's a professor in the Kansas University School of Law. Been talking about interesting subject really pertaining here to Kansas and how our judges are elected, the process by which it happens. And Steve, as always, want to thank you for coming on the program. You have any parting thoughts before we sign off with you today?
Thank you, Paul. Just want to say keep up the good work of spreading awareness around the state of this important issue and so many others.
Well, thank you very much. Steve Ware, you just have a wonderful day.
You too. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We're very happy to have Professor Steve Ware on the program. And now let's get into my interview with Dr. David McCardo. All right, radio listeners, today we have a special guest in Dr. David McCardo. David is an author and playwright. He's penned 3 novels, 1 biography, and an interactive children's book, and also serves as a motivational speaker. McCardo launched a successful career in writing after having served as an administrator and teacher for nearly 4 decades. He brings to the microphone a vibrant voice, energetic personality. David McCardo, we'd like to welcome you to the Conscience of Kansas Radio program.
I am delighted to be part of this broadcast today to share a little bit about my work as an author and as a New Yorker, too, because they kind of go hand in hand.
Well, tell folks a little bit about these books. They're very interesting. Tell them a little bit about that.
All right, let me back up a little bit and tell you that by all standards, I am what is considered an accidental author. I wrote a play that opened off Broadway. Several years after that, I wrote a play, a romantic musical comedy, that opened just off Broadway, and that was a thrill for me, walking into a theater house and seeing my name on the marquee and all that goes with that. And I was ready to write a new play, and through a series of events and conversations, I started to write it as a book. And this was back in 2001. By 2002, the book had been published. It was titled Ferry. And it was about the shoeshine man on the Staten Island ferry. But the book really, if you parallel it to any kind of a boat where people go on, use it as the conveyance to get to work, it could be anywhere in the world. The Bosporus Strait, the Panama Canal, any place where there might be a shoeshine man. What I did is I put the shoeshine man and the concession owner, a fellow named Max, and I put them on the boat, and we watched 7 people go into the city on this given day in the 1950s. And we watched their lives evolve in that 10-hour period.
Don't go anywhere. The Conscience of the Kansas Radio program will be back in a moment.
We just walk on by. We just keep on dreaming.
Welcome back to the Conscience of Kansas radio program with Paul A. Ibbetson.
Thank you, Emily, and welcome everyone back to the program. We're glad you're listening. Don't forget to check out our master website of superior conservative values at IbbetsonUSA.com. All right, let's get back to my interview with Dr. David McCardo at this time.
One becomes a dancer, one little boy who was supposed to get adopted doesn't get adopted, but somebody on the boat takes him home at the end of the book. There's a young Negro boy who is finishing up a career in the military, and we watch him, and the extraordinary thing about him is he speaks Italian, the language of the shoeshine man. So we've got 7 characters, and the book, I remember, always had in mind that it was supposed to be a play, and I hope someday to make it a play, but Ferry is launched. But simultaneously with the book coming out, I ran for political office as an assemblyman against a 20-year incumbent. And during that time, I lost by 152 votes, which confirmed with me that I should get back into the classroom where I was at the time. And I shelved Ferry. But in 2005, when I retired, I woke up January 3rd, and I started calling people and asking them, you have an organization, would you like to have an author come? And since 2005, I've been to almost 380 book signing guest appearances.
Wow. Tell us a little bit about Officer's Oath.
All right. Let me stop a minute and just say that if anyone wants any of the books, they can buy them directly from me, and I'm going to give a phone number.
Sure.
718-979-5196. 718-979-5196. Officer's Oath. Terry Lakin is an Army officer, a surgeon. Terry Lakin has been in Afghanistan many times. With the advent of a new president, Terry Lakin received orders to go to Afghanistan and questioned the orders. Now, he's allowed to. In the military, the officer is allowed what's called satisfaction in the courts. It shouldn't have gotten to that point, but he asked the White House a question, and the White House refused to give him an answer. So he ordered his own court-martial. In the process, this was a several years down the road. This took many years to get to this point. He goes into the court, and rather than flushing out the answer from the White House regarding the question that Terry had, they, quote, really picked him up on, quote, dereliction of duty because he didn't go to a certain meeting at a certain time, which is not uncommon for officers to do. It was with excuse, but they didn't even hear the case. All Terry Lakin wanted to know was he fulfilling his officer's oath? Now, I want the audience to listen to a paraphrase of two oaths. When a young man or young woman goes in the service, they raise their right hand and they say, I do solemnly swear to defend the Constitution of the United States and obey the orders of the President. When that young man or woman becomes an officer, they say the following oath, I do solemnly swear to defend the Constitution of the United States. There's a difference. Terry Lakin wanted to be sure that what he had taken as an oath was something that he could stick to and fulfill that oath. He had to know for sure, for certain, without a doubt, that the chain of command was a chain of command that he could trust and that he knew it was valid. In the field of battle, the person who gets an oath, they have to know that the orders they are being given came down a duly authorized, constitutionally ordained channel of command.
Right.
He asked Mr. Obama for his birth certificate way before Donald Trump did and everybody else did. His conviction was so strong that he ordered his own court-martial. He wound up in Leavenworth Prison, and my wife sent him a copy of Ferry, my first book. And when he came out, the people who were in and around working with him, who were going to be helping him author a biography of his childhood and, of course, the events leading to his imprisonment and his expulsion from the Army, they called me and teamed me up with Jack Cashel. Jack is a national bestseller, a writer that I admire to the utmost. For those of you who have read Jack's books, they're incredible. And they took this kid from New York City and Jack from Kansas City. They teamed us up, and I wrote a section of the book based on the people who were involved in Terry's case, and he actually did the diary and the biographical sketch of Terry. And the book came out. It's called Officer's Oath. It's on Amazon. Those men and women who unselfishly decided they would give their life, every resource they had, and their fortunes, and some of them had fortunes, for the constitutionality of life, that one must be free and hold no bond, no one should hold bondage of them, nor should they put a tax on them without some kind of representation. Terry falls into that long line. Will he go down in history as a hero? In my heart he is. In the heart of thousands of people who have read his book, maybe more than that, who know him, know of his story, Terry stands out as a person who was willing to stand alone. Little did he know there were many people standing with him. That's officer's oath. One can argue with Terry for his decision. They can call him, quote, an expatriate for all that he did. They could crucify him. They could tell him he was a dereliction of duty, disobedient to the commander-in-chief. All Terry wanted to know was that the commander-in-chief was someone who was truly, constitutionally, allowed to make decisions that would affect his life and the lives of people under him, period.
Yeah, such a simple question to be forwarded.
Oh, yeah.
And we've had so much drama over getting the answers, trying to get the answers to that. Of course,
I think what your readers have to do is they've got to go to some expertise in this, and that's Jerome Corsi.
Mm-hmm.
Jerome Corsi wrote the book, Where's the Birth Certificate?
Mm-hmm.
And Jerome, you know, he's a scholar, PhD, Harvard. He's got all the credentials that everybody wants to hear.
Yeah.
Okay, folks, he's got a degree from Harvard.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a doctorate. He's done his research. He has many people in Hawaii. He was able to press the print screen button before Obama took all the information off the net about his background, which has been carefully hidden to the tune of millions. He and Joe Farah with WorldNet Daily have documentation that is questionable, that we bring questions mm-hmm. to the credibility of this president. People voted him in this time. Whether the vote was a valid vote or not is not even argumentative. He won. It's done. Now we live with the next 4 years.
Yeah. Well, so, you know, Jerome Corsi and Jack Cashel are both regular guests here on this program because I want to get the truth out to people, and I'm interested in the truth, and they are folks that go out there. I think a book like Officer's Oath, you know, whether it will create a positive feel for this officer or not, it gets that information out there. I don't think if books like this aren't written, I think the stories of guys like this are just under the rug. I mean, they're sitting in Leavenworth, and we've got a lot of good guys, in my opinion, in Leavenworth, that their stories would just not be told at all. And so it allows the discussion to get out there, and that is powerful.
Paul, what it is there has to be a voice crying in the wilderness.
Mm-hmm.
And they're out there. I wrote in Terry's book about almost 30 people who were in and around Terry's case. What they were voices crying in the wilderness. Our nation is divided right now.
Mm-hmm.
We have a nation that's split right in half. We don't know what would have happened had Mr. Romney won. The issue is Mr. Obama has won, and we have pretty good idea where the country is going. But there have to be voices crying in the wilderness. Look, we go back historically. Amidst the religions of the world, one voice cried out, religion is not the answer. There's one who's going to come who's greater than religion, who is the author of all that you believe, all that you're looking for. His name is Jesus. Today we have men and women crying out in the wilderness. Mickey Booth,
mm-hmm.
Orly Tates, Joe, Jerome, Jack Cashel, who is relentless. He's part of that group now, I understand, pretty much on a regular basis. Crying in the wilderness, hey, folks, make straight your paths. Make sure you know your Constitution. Make sure you believe the system that we inherited from the very beginning, a republic that cannot be so quickly dampened. The country's divided. We have perilous days ahead, and I'm not a prophet. But I have an outstanding grasp of the obvious. We are in trouble.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. And ladies and gentlemen, we've been speaking with Dr. David Mercado. We're talking about his books, many of them, and we're about to run out of time. David, could you give your phone number one more time? And if folks order their books, will you send them to them signed?
They will be signed, and they can call me, and I will, you know, the office will facilitate it real quick. 718-979-5196. 718-979-5196. Some of the books are available on Amazon, and is even some of the books are available on eBay. I've had the distinction of having a fellow put Ferry on eBay, and he wants $150 for it. So I'm thrilled.
That wasn't me.
I didn't do that.
That's the free market at work. You never know what a book may go for. And folks, when you call in to get your book, tell me you heard this interview on the Kansas radio show, and so they'll know the power of this program and that people are listening. And Dr. David Mercado, we just want to thank you so much for your time to talk about these wonderful books and wonderful important subjects, and for coming on the Conscience of Kansas radio program. Dancing with myself.